Hi there, my name is Marcel van der Kwast. Thank you for listening to this episode of my podcast, which is called Here is AMC, that's Dutch. In it, I talk to interesting people in the field of employer branding, recruitment marketing, and everything related to those topics. Normally, this podcast is in Dutch, but for this episode, I hope you can hear that I try to speak English. That's because my guest today is Emily Firth. She was one of the keynotes at the Employer Branding Summit organized by Recruiters United. After her keynote, she came by my microphones to talk a little bit more employer branding. Welcome, Emily.
Thanks for having me, Marcel, and thanks for that lovely introduction and your best English. Much appreciated.
Well, my best English, I hope it's good enough. For a short introduction of you, you started your career at a number of advertising agencies before becoming Global Head of Employer Branding at Booking.com. From 2017 until 2019, if I'm correct. Since then, you're an independent employer branding strategy consultant under the name of The Truth Works. And that name is, well, that triggers me a lot. Go search for Emily online, and it's absolutely clear what you stand for in the employer branding landscape. Stand out from the crowd is my short summary of that. And that's what you just told here in the keynote at the Employer Branding Summit. The title of your keynote was 50 Shades of Beige. Emily, first question. How do I prevent that employer branding becomes employer blending?
Yeah, we hear that phrase a lot, don't we, Marcel? Employer blending. Yes, my keynote was about 50 Shades of Beige. So the fact that sometimes when we look at those employer branding stories and content online, it all feels very much the same. And I believe that that is because we're not writing good enough briefs. We're not getting to the heart of insights and human truths and truths about what's going on in the world and truths about who we are as a company before we get into that creative execution. And if you go into every creative brief with the same brief, which is basically tell people about what a great company we are and get them to apply, you're going to end up in a very similar space. So we have to get to something interesting before we get into that creative execution.
Yep. And is that typically something of the employer branding experience or the employer branding expertise, or is it also in other expertises?
I think it's true in the marketing world. So as you mentioned, that's my background. I worked in advertising agencies for a long time. So what I learned there is that your work is only as good as the brief. So what you get out is only as good as what you put in to
garbage
creating
in,
a
garbage
campaign.
Out.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. That's the polite way of putting it.
And is it because in employer branding, there's always the employer brand story or the EVP, whatever you call it. Does that already has to be as sharp as the examples you just shown in your presentation?
Well, I think a lot of people write their EVPs based on just what's true inside the company. And what they forget to do is add that external lens. So how are the people outside of your company going to react to that?
Yep.
And if you're talking about being innovative or if you're talking about, you know, being the next big thing, how are people going to receive that? And what landscape are you putting that story out into? Because if you miss that connection, you've forgotten about your actual audience who exist in the world and who don't care about your EVP.
Okay, and that's, I think, the last part of your sentence, they don't care about your EVP. I think that's the first thing we as employer branders have to look in the mirror for, because how can we make them interested in our employer brand?
Yeah.
And one of the phrases I picked up from your presentation was show, don't tell. That sounds like an awful cliche, but it's so truth. And well, the name of your company is The Truth Works. Can you elaborate on that? But because one thing in employer branding is it has to be true. But I think too many employers are just showing the truth. Why do they do that, do you think?
I think the tendency is to come up with a very literal answer. So if you are told we need to demonstrate innovation, people start talking about innovation, or they say, okay, we'll get our head of technology to talk about innovation. And unfortunately, that's the same thing everyone's doing. And there's no compelling reason to watch that. Why would someone who isn't interested in your company be compelled to watch someone telling them that you're innovative? It's far more exciting to see something innovative, to see an innovative approach, or to hear a story about something innovative that has happened that they can connect to and that they can relate to. And I think the mistake we make is thinking that the first answer and the most obvious answer is the only answer. And that's not true. I think we need to dig a little bit deeper and find that connection between what we want to say to our audience and what they're actually interested in receiving and hearing.
Yeah, and putting an effort in how we're going to say it.
Yeah,
and I think
absolutely.
That's the finger on the, well, I don't know it's an English verb, but the finger on the painful spot.
Yeah,
I think
exactly.
In recruitment, it's too much. Well, talking recruitment and not putting an effort in earning attention or something like it. In your presentation, you show a video from your booking time. It's a testimonial video, but it's from a blind developer, and it really made an impact. But can you, and I will take care that with this podcast, I put the link to that video so that people who listen this can also watch the video. But can you, take us under the hood of that video? Why is that not just an ordinary testimonial video?
Yeah, I think it's a great example. The series we created at Booking was actually called Perspectives, and it was designed to bring our EVP to life. So one of the pillars of the EVP was around problem solving and around how actually all of the technology at Booking was designed to solve problems for people. And we wanted to appeal to an audience that was motivated and excited and interested in the idea of problem solving. So we thought we could talk about problem solving in theory. We could talk about,
who cares?
Yeah, exactly. Why would someone watch that? Or we could tell that story through the lens of someone who had problem solving baked into everything that they do day to day, both in their role, but also in their life.
Yeah.
And to find those stories, you have to act like a journalist. To find those stories, you have to connect with people in your organization. You have to talk to people. You have to talk to people in the water queue and actually surface those stories. And that takes time, that takes energy, that takes effort. Then you have to build a connection with those people to make them feel comfortable to tell their story, which is often very personal. And in the case of Param, please do watch it if you haven't and follow him online, Param Dowster, he's fantastic. You have to make people comfortable to tell their story. So that was a series of interviews and conversations that were had with him. And then we pulled the story together from his own words. So there were no scripts, there was nothing, we need to just say this.
The text is written by himself because some lines, they just sounded like a hard time copywriting or something. Beautiful sentences, but it those are his own words.
Yeah, absolutely. And you'll know as a podcaster and interviewer, Marcel, that if you actually connect with the person you're talking to and you build a relationship with them, they will tell you things which feel really authentic and interesting and inspiring, and they'll tell you them in their own words, but that takes actually an effort instead of just sticking a camera
what you
in front
say,
of someone.
The view of a journalist, you have to act like a journalist, but that's also the problem because today we're at an event organized by Recruiters United, and a recruiter is not a journalist. How do you connect all those views, because you need the view of a recruiter, but you also need the view of a journalist, of a communication specialist. But how can you do that as a recruiter or something?
Yeah. I think recruiters have an extraordinary advantage and ability. If you're a good recruiter, you understand what motivates and drives your candidate. You understand what's going to get them to say yes.
Yeah.
It's the difference between a recruiter who says, okay, how quickly can I close this deal? And shoots too soon with the wrong selling proposition, or someone that actually takes the time to interview, speak to the candidate, get to know them, get to know what their barriers and drivers
are. They will
feel
it immediately. Yep.
Absolutely. And, selling a role to someone who is worried about moving their family halfway across the world is a completely different sales pitch to someone who's driven by money and motivated by how quickly they can get promoted. And you would sell and pitch that story in a completely different way.
Yep.
That's exactly the same as the way we have to work in employer branding. Understand the people we're talking to and pitch our story and our communications to them in a way that's compelling. So I think recruiters have a huge advantage in employer branding, one they don't necessarily leverage always. But those are the insights they could give fantastically to an employer branding or communications expert.
Yeah, perfect. And one more question about that video. What was the name of the developer again?
Param Dowster.
Param. Now Param is an example of, it's a blind programmer. So the developer. So that's a story in itself. It was a series. Were there also, I should almost, ordinary people in it? And were they How did you prevent those from getting boring?
I don't think anyone's ordinary. I think everyone has something interesting, and everyone has an interesting story to tell, which hopefully you also get out of your guests.
And with some, you have to dig deeper and try harder and well, listen better. Okay. Okay.
So we had all kinds of stories, people who'd moved countries and found connections here. You know, people who had completely shifted careers and were applying, you know, a career in theatre to being the office receptionist, for example. You just have to find what's interesting about people. And if you're interested in people, usually you will find something interesting.
Yep. Okay. 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 That's enough about that part. Let's dig in the your brief, because you have four questions that you have to answer in the brief to make it stand well, to get it sharp. Can you name those four, please?
You're testing my memory here.
Oh, no.
No, it's okay. I'm joking. You need to start with your brand identity. You need to start with understanding how you look at the world. You need to understand an audience insight. So you need to understand what people think and feel about what you want to talk to them about.
And that means, as an employer, you have to make choices, because I think that second one in your list actually triggers me the most, because there you have to, well, to choose your problem factual.
Yeah, exactly. And what's the problem you're solving, and why should people care about it?
Yeah, and I think most employers make the mistake to try to solve, well, all problems with one magic stick, and that our problem is too broad.
Yep.
So there you have to be sharp and to make choices. Okay.
Absolutely. And the third one actually also speaks to that. So the third one is around coming up with a single-minded proposition. So one single clear thing you want to tell them in a way that only you can do. And it has to be one thing, because the way communications works, and you learn this as soon as you go into marketing, is people can really only take in one message. Yep. They can really only understand one thing, especially in our, you know, hyper-connected world where we look at something for 5 seconds. You can't land 15 messages in one piece
of content. They've once taught me that with the law of the oranges.
Right.
If I throw one orange at you, no problem, you catch it. If I throw two oranges at you, well, maybe you catch one of them, but that's how communication works.
It's a very good analogy. Yep. Yeah, I like that a lot. How many oranges can you catch? Only one.
Maybe you can try it on stage.
One, I think, is my limit. And the last one was around what's your desired outcome?
Yep.
And the answer, if you ask any recruiter or hiring business partner, they'll always say, oh, we want people to apply, of course. If you look at the landscape we're in, yeah, sure, absolutely everyone wants people to apply at the moment, but what do you actually want them to do as a result of your communication?
Yep.
Do you want them to research you? Do you want them to think or feel something they might not have felt? Do you want them to change their perception of you? It might be that you are a really old school company and your barrier is that people see you as really old fashioned. So actually your desired outcome is that they rethink about how you are as a company. If you don't have a really sharp desired outcome, you're also going to end up in a very generic, bland, beige space.
And for me, because how you explained the fourth one, that's also making choices in your result. Because if you name the end result, yes, of course, there's logic. Everybody wants that. But what are we going to solve with this part? So the two things I took from those list of four is the 1-2 combination between number 2 and 3, that's choosing your problem and naming your solution for that problem. That's, well, I can start with that tomorrow because mostly it's too broad. And the second one is the result, how you're going to name your result instead of making it too obvious. So I think that's a really good list that everyone can start to work with tomorrow. If you are an employer with lots of target groups, lots of different audiences, that means you have to put in a lot of work with all kinds of different things. But it's also, and maybe that's also from your background and also my background of communication agencies, it's a way to put something into communication. But does it always mean you have to brief an agency for a large campaign?
No, I don't think so. I think the most important thing is getting your message right. And the people who understand your audience are hopefully your recruiters and your hiring managers. I just think we need to get better at asking them better questions, because they have more insights than they realize. They speak to people who are turning those roles down or accepting those roles every day.
Yep.
Why are they accepting them? why are they declining them? What do we then learn about the people that we're trying to talk to that we can then apply? And then going through that briefing process that I showed, you know, actually using the brief that you've written and the insights that you have to challenge the ideas you come up with will get you to better solutions. And that could be as simple as a line you use on a banner ad.
Yep.
Or a whole piece of content that you create. But the importance is the message and whether you're actually connecting with someone on a level that they would be interested in.
And I think also that within your own company, it can be very, it can be very handy to slice up the total problem in different, in different solutions. And that's also when you have put it sharply in the brief like you propose it. In my organization, I can go to every stakeholder and get them with me on those choices, or otherwise have discussion about the choice. And that's better than having the same discussion when you have presented your proposal in as an answer to the brief. So I also think that brief is a very good thing to, well, for stakeholder management, for the internal part.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we need to get better at pushing back on those briefs, whether in-house or... Whether we're in-house or whether we're external partners, we need to get better at pushing back on those briefs.
Yep.
Because bad briefs will get you to bad outcomes.
And is it... You are British and you live in Amsterdam. Is it, well, is the Dutch employer brand market, is it different? Do we things differently than the international part that's around Amsterdam? Or
no, I don't think so. But I think that there is a tendency to believe that everyone's heard of your brand via word of mouth and that you don't need to work as hard, perhaps. But a lot of Dutch companies are also trying to attract international talent. So they have the same challenges, which are, how do we get people to care about us outside of this market? So I think the companies that you see that do well in all of the sort of Universum surveys and all of the, you know, top employers tend to be the homegrown success stories that everyone's heard of, who have big brands in the market. I think it's harder for companies coming here trying to break through to tell that story.
But it's the challenge that we should all go to build it up from zero to well, suppose they don't know us, then we have to earn the attention.
Yeah, well, I also think that having a clear brand can be a disadvantage because people can have a reputation of you as a local employer or an old school employer or an employer that doesn't care about its people. And I think in some of the examples that my colleague, my friend Ed showed just before I went on, you know, he was showing that disconnect between you're able to tell a great story, but in a small market, everyone knows the truth anyway. Yeah. Yeah. So it could actually work against you and be harder in many ways than an international company that can hide in different markets.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. Now, well, I think we're almost done. I think this one, well, this should put everything who has been here today on their forefeet, because this is what's now needed on this market. Because we have to fight for the attention, and that means we have to be sharp. So it comes really handy. As a last question, I would like to ask you. You already gave a lot of practical tips that people who have listened, they should go. They should start with this on next Monday. If you can give them one practical advice, they look at you with puppy eyes and say, "How can I start with this on Monday?" What would you give them as a first step?
Read the brief you're about to give your employer brand person in-house, or you're about to give to an agency, or whoever you're about to brief. And if you can't think of a single way that you would answer that brief, whether you're creative or not, it's not a good brief. If there's nothing in there that sparks an idea, however basic, then your brief isn't working.
Okay. Well, how practical do you want to get it? Okay, thank you very much for now. I think it's a nice dessert after your presentation. So thank you. And good luck with The Truth Works. I really like the name of your company because, like you said in your presentation, it has both sides and the truth, and it has to work. So thank you for today. Good luck with the your project and
and the other project.
On the personal project.
I'm about to have a baby for anyone that can't see podcast.
It's a podcast, yeah. And maybe the viewers also can't see, but so all the best with that. And thank you, and we'll hear from you again.
Lovely, thanks. And thanks for having me.
Thank you for listening to this episode of Hier is AMC. Together with Recruiters United, I've made 5 special episodes with speakers at the Employer Branding Summit 2021. Listen to all of them for an overview or pick the episodes you are specially interested in. You can find all details about the event and the podcast episodes at recruitersunited.com or hierisamc.nl. Thank you for listening and until next time. Tot zover deze aflevering. We hebben een serie gemaakt van 5 afleveringen met verschillende sprekers van de Employer Branding Summit. Luister ze allemaal voor een mooi totaaloverzicht of kies er een paar uit met het onderdeel dat jou specifiek interesseert. Je vindt alle afleveringen op recruitersunited.com en op hierisamc.nl. Bedankt voor het luisteren en tot een volgende keer.